There we go. How's everyone doing? This is Jose Trujillo, once again, from the artist studio. In my trusted Starbucks. Let's see. I'm gonna do a landscape painting today on this 8 by 10 inches canvas board. And it's gonna be pretty cool. Stick around and watch. So, some of you people have asked me, you wonderful people have asked me about the brushes that I use or the paint that I use. As I mentioned, I'm gonna be doing some videos where I show the whole thing. But right now I'm afraid that if I do them like that, the camera is not really gonna show the painting is gonna become smaller. And as you see here, I pan into it. But I will be getting that stuff so soon. But for now, I'm gonna be explaining to you what I'm gonna be using, okay? For this painting, I'm using a number, I think it's a number 4. Yeah, no, number 6, sorry, brush. And I don't use very high-end stuff when it comes to brushes and stuff like that. I used to. I don't anymore just because it just, you know, after you do it for a while, you start recognizing what you need in terms of more, you know, price stuff or, you know, that kind of stuff. So, let's do this. Right here, I'm going to mix, I'm mixing a little subtle cadmium yellow, cadmium red, sorry about that, and yellow pale, okay? Just a little mixture to make a bright orange like that, okay? I'm also using the radiant green, phthalo blue, to create, with a little bit of white, to create this little distance right here, little mountain distance. And this is just to outline it, okay? So as some of you know about, you know, artwork like this, you guys are very well aware that the closer something is, right, the darker it is, for the most part, especially when you're talking about erected surfaces like mountains, trees, and stuff like that. The farther away, the lighter it gets, okay? So I'm gonna work. This is just coming from a traditional standpoint, okay? This is not true in modern painting, Fauvism. This is just values, very basic stuff, especially for people who do more realism. But it doesn't hurt to know it. When you want to use it, you can use it. When you don't, you put it aside. I pull out the palette because I like to scrub this first. Okay, some occasions. This is one of them. In some occasions, guys. Now I'm using this purple. You could use dioxazone purple. It's one of my favorite ones. With some magenta. A little bit of magenta to create this back mountain right here, or hillside. Okay, notice how I scrub down. This is one of the ways that I like to do it in order to get a defined area. People do it different ways. I do it different ways sometimes, but for right now I'm showing you this. This is one of the many ways that I like to do it. You scrub down, okay? So if you squint your eyes, you will notice that, of course, this is darker, not just by color, but the value is darker. It's called values, okay? And it goes from light to dark. So, Oh, I sound like I know what I'm talking about, you guys. What the hell's going on with me? Now in the background, for the back hillside, I'm mixing this one, right? This purple one, the absent purple with magenta. I'm putting a little bit of viridian just to make it somewhat gray. Enough where you can almost make it blue gray. I like that right there. Just because it looks super awesome. Okay. Then again, it doesn't, you know, this is what Renoir used to have a saying. They have to marry. He had a more vulgar way of doing it, of saying it. But essentially that's what it means. They have to touch, they have to marry. Okay. The colors. Don't be afraid of them not touching. You want them to touch. You can always go back and reaffirm them in different ways. But you want the color to touch the other color. At least if you're doing what I'm, you know. If you're doing my jam, you guys. If you're not doing my jam, it's cool. Then because this is Impressionism, I start playing with color. Once I've defined, okay, the values in some way, I start playing with color. This is not the proper way or the only way. This is how I do it, okay? And this is not how I do it all the time. This is one of the many ways I do it. So I don't want to confuse you. You can do whatever you want. I'm just telling you, this is how I do it sometimes. Okay, now I'm going to get some yellow, a little bit of cadmium red, of course. Cadmium red is the bomb. Cadmium red is where it's at. I like permanent rose too. It's very impressionist. Especially if you're into that. With white, okay? It's not just cadmium red and yellow. Any pale yellow, any you know, don't use one of those darker yellows. Very dark. I mean, it doesn't matter if you use one of those dark yellows. It's just not too dark. So that you're able to play with it. Tone it down as you need. I'm gonna do some viridian green. You could use viridian blue, or, you know, in this case I'm using viridian green, which is viridian, with some yellow, and create a nice lemon sorbet right here. You see this? This is pure gold, you guys, pure gold. If gold could be painted, it'd look like this. This is half the fun is really this. The other half, you have to learn how to make it fun, you know? Subject matter and all this stuff. Many artists lose their minds right there, or go through times where they lose their minds. I think it's like any other practice, right? Like writer's block or crazy stuff like that. It's good to hang out with artists who are, if in your town or whatever, who are accomplished. And what I mean accomplished is not that they just paint well. That are working artists, that's what they do for a living. Go hang out with them. Tell them about me, tell them how cool I am. Go hang out with them and see their work ethic. Because you will find out that their work ethic is stronger than their quote-unquote skill set or their talent, quote-unquote talent is what I meant to say. It's one of the things that I always see. The more professional the artist, the more accomplished, their work ethic, the higher the work ethic is. They have very, very strong work ethic. Because of course, you know, that's what they do, and So they have to get not just good at their craft, they have to get good at their working out their schedules and working out their emotions. And, you know, because we have a tendency to say that artists are emotional and that we only paint when we feel like it or when we have an inspiration come in or any of that, you know, BS. That's really not the case with working artists. It doesn't work that way. And again, what I mean with working artists is full-time working artists, okay? Not artists that work on it here and there or have a daytime job somewhere else. Or you will notice that. So when I say go hang out with them, it's not, you know, just to hang out and drink a beer at the local pub or whatever, wherever you are in the world. It's to pick up on those habits. Why? You go to them to studio if they're okay with that, if they're cool. Some of them like to work in solitude. I certainly worked in solitude for a long time. Now I'm like on YouTube. Go figure out. But if they're cool with it, you know, take the artist some lunch or something, you know. Be cool and be like, hey, I'm going to stop with some Chinese or something. And can I watch you paint for a little bit? Not necessarily for learning, because a lot of artists, you know, I don't know, they tend to think that someone's going to steal their Coca-Cola, their Coca-Cola secrets. But there are no secrets. They fool themselves into thinking that they have secrets, but because other people say that, but really that's not it. You know, really what happened is that they fool themselves into thinking that the reality is that they have very strong work ethic. And some people don't understand work ethic, so they start saying that they have secrets or that, you know, stuff like that. Anyways, be cool with the artist. Invite him, you know, whatever. Be like, I'm gonna stop by. It is one of the strongest, one of the best things you can do. To go hang out with a working artist. Now, the bigger the art community, the harder that may be, right? But the more challenging, I guess. But you'd be surprised. The worst thing you can tell them is something like, I like you to teach me, you know? And not because they don't want to teach you, but because they're I mean, it's they're working, right? So they might not be very interested in that. But a good way you could, you know, you could be like, hey, by the way, I was, you know, wondering if, I don't know, I'm an aspiring artist, I don't want to bother you, I know that you're working or whatever, I know that, you know, you're doing your thing. I just really want to see you work, not for the purpose of your artistic, super awesome secrets and abilities. don't say it like me, okay? I'm just joking, but pick your words, something like that. Really what I want to do is just be around someone and see what it's like to be around someone who's working, you know, and doing this. And it, you know, you'd be surprised. It might not be around painting. It might be around the studio, cleaning up the studio, working on the social media, this or that. You'll be surprised. But give something and you know, of course, it's, don't try to offer. Don't try to offer money. Not because they won't take it, but because that might not be the best way right away to do it. Or who knows, maybe, I don't know. But maybe the, you know, some lunch, some coffee, you know, just to hang out a little bit. Don't go cheap on them though. all these things, right? Well, the reason I'm saying is if you want value back, you need to give value to them. So whatever value you could offer, right? Maybe you're a photographer, you know, and be like, I'd like to exchange some professional photographs or, you know, your artwork or your portfolio or whatever in exchange to hanging out one day. Just hang out with you one day. Something like that. I don't know. Maybe you have a different business.
Maybe you are a I don't know, you can offer some art supplies or something. It's not like they need it, but at least they can, you know, it could be something like, oh, okay, cool. A working artist doesn't need it. A working artist, I mean, that's what they do, so they're not lacking. It's not like a quote-unquote starving artist, no? That's what they do, so they don't lack supplies or anything like that. But it's nice to, you know, present something to them. Anyways, I'm not saying that so you guys can tell me, those of you who live close by. No, I'll just say that it's a good it's a good thing if you're trying to figure it out, you know. Oh, now I'm gonna jump from the palette knife. I did the background with palette knife. Okay, this is one of the funnest stuff that I like to do because it doesn't all have to be the same thing. It doesn't all have to be with the same tool either. I was almost forgetting. Sometimes I do it, sometimes I don't, but this is one of those times I don't, okay? So now I go into it with a brush. Now, one of the reasons it doesn't get muddy in me or whatever, some artists tell me, that, hey, it's so cool, you know, you get to, the brush sticks. Well, here's a little trick, okay, you guys? The background is not so thick. So think about that one. Every time you're gonna lay colors or whatever, think about your background. Background, whatever I just painted right now with a palette knife, that's why I scraped. I painted scraping it so that I didn't form a layer, heavy layers of impasto. Impasto is jargon for paste, right? Heavy layers of paste. Now my heavy layers are here in my trees. These are where my heavier. They're not so heavy because I'm gonna go back to them, but they're heavy enough to be awesome like that, okay? Just to show themselves there. To stick around. To stick on the wall. Now, there's a million ways to do this brush work, but I'm just showing you one way. There's many ways. There's this. There's so many ways, okay? That's why when those of you who've seen my other videos, I've told you before, don't get stuck on one idea because it might not be yours and you might miss, you know. Doesn't mean that you have to be trying everything. It means that you're open. That's all it means. You know. If you find what you like, stay there. But if you haven't found that thing that you like, that brushwork or, you know, those colors or whatever, then it's okay to look around. You know, it's sort of like dating. I don't know, those of you who, I don't know anything about dating. I stopped dating a long time ago, but I imagine those of you who know, those of you who are experts in the field. See? Something like that. Bam. Very, very little bit of purple is going to go here, mixed, okay, in the orange that I had there, the umbery orange. I mix the purple, I pre-mix it. So that's why you're seeing this sort of a brick, brown brick color. This is, of course, underneath, right? To show some depth, to show volume. And then clean up my brush a little bit and come back with it, but with a little bit of white on top. Right? This is very simple stuff. This is not this is just to get you to get a feel don't be upset with yourself if you don't land it. Like, I mean, I'm no Bob Ross. Like, don't be upset if you don't land it the first time and you can't make the happy little tree.
That's not the exercise here. It's just to allow yourself to paint and to mess up. It's okay. If you don't mess up at least, you know, I don't know, my motto is not 1,000, 10,000 times. You're in no progress. You have to constantly, because messing up allows you to adjust. See, many people see messing up as bad. I used to see it as bad. Messing up is not bad. Messing up, what we consider messing up, is adjustment. You cannot adjust yourself unless you did something quote unquote wrong, you know? And you cannot adjust yourself. As you're wondering with this one, this is red, a little bit of Mars black, this color, and purple. Because I'm cool like that. I get to do my own stuff. I don't follow the status quo, whatever status quo. Status quo it's not here to help me paint or doesn't feed me. Status quo is not really much help, so I don't follow it. If anything, status quo is a hindrance to me as an artist. So yeah, I'm a rebel like that. Sometimes I mix colors that for some people might be muddy. This is something that I admire about Spanish painters, and one of my favorite ones is Josepe de Rivera. And if you've seen his paintings, many of the artists during the Baroque and, you know, around that time, many of the artists painted like, if you get close enough, it looks like not only an abstracted mess, but the colors look extremely muddy. And I know some people have like all these theories. They talk about like, oh, it's because they're old and over time, blah blah. Yeah, no, that maybe some of that may be happening. You know, I'm not going to discredit some of that happening. But as an artist, you can tell when some of those artists purposely mix their colors, because before they went on their own, they were apprenticing, and they apprenticed not here and there, they apprenticed night and day, because they acted as, I mean, they were they were what do we call those people nowadays, the ones that go get the coffee. I forgot what the interns. Essentially, they were interns that got to do the work of the maestro, no? So they had it bad. They didn't have it all that nice, but I mean, who cares? They didn't care about that. That didn't matter to them. At least from, it wouldn't ever not matter to me if you're learning how to paint from, you know, you're Caravaggio and you're you know, some bigwigs intern. It wouldn't matter to you, because you were gonna learn the trade. And it's not the secrets. A lot of people are like, the secrets of the trade. Yeah, that's not really. It's the work ethic. There's a little note right there. There's a little pebble. For those of you who are looking to learn that kind of stuff. There we go. Something like that. Bam! Because I can. Because I want it. Because I did. Awesome. Thank you so much for joining me, guys. I hope you enjoy this little
super awesome painting. And I hope you guys join me for the next one. Till next time. Bye-bye.